Are you tired of your dog losing its cool in a thunderstorm or fireworks? You might want to look at tongue treats. Tonguetreats.com. High anxiety relief, pain relief, inflammation relief. It's a direct connection between the tongue and the brain. Doesn't waste time going down to the stomach, where it gets broken down, enters the bloodstream, then to the brain eventually. By then, little Izzy, my dog, has been hiding under the house for like 20 minutes. The Tongue Treat CBD strips provide rapid results for your pet with the right amount of CBD, which is not psychoactive. It's important to test and verify your pet is getting the proper dosage. A single strip should be enough. Have doubts? There's certified analysis from a lab available on the website. Think about it. Efficacy and economy. Tongue Treats. This is the Hard Parking Podcast, brought to you by Right Honda out of Scottsdale, Arizona, and I am your host, Jay Finning. First and foremost, happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there and the fathers pulling double duty. You know, last year, one of my biggest episodes was the Father's Day episode, and I don't think I really spent much time on Mother's Day. But my mother's just important to me as hopefully anyone's mother. If you're fortunate enough to have a mother, some people are raised without a mother. And my relationship with my mother is really good. However, she was always a disciplinarian in my house. It wasn't my father. My father wasn't home a lot. He traveled for work most of the time. And so my mother took care of my brother and I. When I was younger, of course, really small, my mother is who I'd always run to. I remember being in the rocking chair, crying, and her comforting me. And I think it's easy for people to say, well, that's the mother's role. The mother is the nurturer and the father is the disciplinarian. And again, my mother was kind of both. Mom and I helped her cook. I helped her do stuff around the house, but we got into it a lot as well. And I was a smart mouth ass little kid. And my mother, if anybody who listens to this actually knows my mother, she's pretty rigid. She's very matter of fact. And if you know me well, I may seem that way. I have to believe a lot of that comes from her. In fact, my kids, my wife are like, "Woo, don't want to cross your mom." Yeah, because she is cutthroat. But she's a great woman, and I think you don't really appreciate it. I didn't really appreciate it until I became older, of course, right? And then, of course, listening to this, it's easy to say, well, yeah, duh, we never do appreciate it until we're older. But I don't know, a lot of you, you're either like this or you've had a lot of friends like this where their mother was talking to them all the time, every day. My wife cannot go a day without talking to her mother. I mean, she lives with us, but when she didn't, that was just part of her life. My wife has a huge family. I have almost no family. We don't do family reunions anymore. And with the passing of my father last October, our family is just getting smaller. But her family structure is so strong. There's just so many people. And it was so foreign to her to be with someone like me who may have talked to my parents, may have talked to my mother once a week, once a month. In fact, if I were to call my mother more than once a week, she even said this. My mother said, yeah, if you talked to me all that time, I'd ask what's going on and why are you calling me? That's my mother. But she's still up there in Minnesota with my brother, and you know, happy Mother's Day to her. And again, happy Mother's Day to all of you. And I really appreciate her. I have to say a lot of my personality comes from the way I was raised. I think my rigidness comes from her and my compassion comes from my father. And that's how I was raised. I think about my mother as someone who didn't support me in the ways I felt like I needed to be supported, where my father on that side, he did. But she did so much more, and I just didn't realize it. She used to ask me, what do you think you're going to be when you grow up? I said, I'd be an artist. And she goes, oh, yeah, sure. And it's easy to say, damn, that's fucked up. I say this, no one knows your kids like you know your kids. No one knows you like your parents or your parents. And so I was obviously not showing that I really had interest in too much of anything. Yeah, I sat there and I drew all day and went to school and had great, you know, great grades in art, but I sucked in English, in math, science, everything else. And so it's easy to say, oh yeah, right. And it challenges you. But she's from a small town. My mother is a small town woman raised in a town of less than 500. In fact, it's like 430. The school was kindergarten through graduation high school. Everybody knew everybody, and times are different. Times are different. Parts of the world are different. I mean, that's small town Minnesota. So happy Mother's Day, Mom. Happy Mother's Day to my mother-in-law. Happy Mother's Day to my wife, my daughter. All you mothers out there, like I said in the beginning. Coming up in a little bit, the Horsepower Hour podcast joins with Andy Imhoff and Coy Sinclair. Really good podcast. I really like listening to that one because it's cars with a lot more cars than this one. Good sound quality, good comedy, and you learn a lot about things that don't seem to really matter as much, but it's valuable information. These guys are like an encyclopedia for cars that aren't Ferraris. And it's kind of a callback to yesteryear when I was first getting into cars in my early 20s, 30s. There was always one or two people in your group that just, they knew everything. They're like Jesse on Fast and Furious, or the cars talk to them when they work on them and they can't concentrate on anything else. Everybody has a genius like that. Like both these guys know, they know a lot. And so that's coming up in a few minutes. But real quick, so I'm recording this on Sunday, May 9th, Mother's Day. Yesterday, I went to a car event with Byron. That's Byron Jones, Trey's AMG. He was just on here a couple episodes ago in studio. We're coming back from a car event and we get on the freeway. And you know, we all do this thing where you start to get on the highway and it's like 3 miles to the next exit and you just punch it. You look around, doesn't seem to be any traffic in your lane coming up behind you so you can merge in front of you and you just punch it. I even put my fingers out the window. Some of you have seen this video on my Instagram page at NA2NSX. I counted down 3, 2, 1, and I just gunned it. Vroom, the car just screaming. Vroom, next gear. Vroom. I look in my rear view and I have this big plume of black smoke that came out of the NSX because the turbo just hasn't been let loose in a while. And I notice Byron's way back there, but I also notice a motorcycle switching lanes and coming up. And I think, oh shit, is that a cop? Oh my God. Totally an officer. Comes pulling up. By this point, I wasn't just gunning it. I wasn't even out of traffic, but I got up to probably 120, 125 from like an 80 pull getting on the highway or 70 or whatever it was. Fast enough to switch into fourth gear, and it's a motorcycle cop. And I'm thinking, oh, fuck. He pulls up next to me, bloop, bloop, kind of looks over at me. I look at him, and I just do the mouth. I just said, I'm so sorry. And gave like this big grimace on my face, grin, kind of like, oops, just got caught my hand in the candy jar. And he looks over at me, kind of shakes his head, points down, like, slow down, keep that shit low, and just pulled off. So fucking lucky. Speaking of officers, there's an article where police departments are starting to switch over to using Teslas because they're 30% more efficient. Apparently, this has been happening with precincts around the United States, but now it's made the news. And I think it's kind of weird, right? So when you're out there and you're driving and you see somebody get pulled over by a minivan, the first thing you think is, that's not fair. The cops were playing dirty. That's dirty. Like, at least give me an opportunity to feel like you're an unmarked car. But don't pull me over in no minivan. Don't pull me over in a pickup truck. But when you see the Tesla, you look at it and you think, wow, that's kind of cool. And it's weird how that kind of works in our minds. And it makes sense for certain situations, because the Teslas, the batteries, they run low if you just ride them hard. But I would have to believe that not every officer out there is just riding hard all the time. Just probably a few times a day. Otherwise, they're probably just sitting around waiting for people to pull them over tickets or just patrolling the neighborhoods or doing whatever it is they do. Because these weren't necessarily unmarked cars. These were Teslas with the lights and the badging on the side. Let me know, what do you think about that? HardParkingPodcast@gmail.com or slide into my DMs. A lot of you slide into my DMs or send me a text message. Not going to give you my phone number, but if you know it, you already know it. Or comment on the Hard Parking Violations Facebook page. I have that article up. Coming up, the Horsepower Hour podcast.
Our social media highlight of the week is Cell Shop, an Arizona-based retailer that strives to be your destination of choice for wireless services. Visit them at cellshop.us.
That was great. You know, I couldn't have done it any better myself. Andy Imhoff, Coy Sinclair of Horsepower Hour podcast. Welcome to the Hard Parking Podcast.
Thank you for having us, my friend. You were on. Coy, was he one of our first guests? I think he was, like first, second, third, something like that.
It was very early on, and it's been a long time coming. I'm very happy to be here.
Well, the thing that, and listen, people listen to you, Jay. Obviously, these are your listeners, so they're listening to you. They're used to you. But the thing that you guys have to understand is from a vocal work perspective. I do a lot of voiceover stuff. I do commercials. I do audiobooks. Now, granted, most of it is self-help, and I try not to sound too suicide-y.
Suicide-y.
But Jay's got one of those voices. He really gets his point across. And I think that if you listen to the Hard Parking Podcast, you're probably like, you know how OnlyFans has like the top 1%, top 5%, but there are so many people on OnlyFans now that it's like you're in the top 0.5%. You're in the top 1%. Jay, your podcast is in the top 0.01% of podcasts that I listen to.
How many podcasts do you listen to?
3 or 4.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I'll take it.
I actually listened to a podcast by a fellow named Roe Jogan. I don't know if you guys know him or not. He's a DMT enthusiast and has done some fighting, you know, in his past. And apparently he's pretty good, but the dude's real, real short. And so, you know, the short man complex is a little bit of a problem. Coy listens to a couple of different podcasts, but I think mostly he just listens to the Horsepower Hour.
I like to hear the sound of my own voice.
Yeah.
I do want to point out we have three near, you know, almost professional, soon to be sponsored.
I'm legitimately an amateur, semi-professional.
If we get two more automotive podcast guys on here, we could literally summon Captain Planet.
Ooh. Well, I mean, if Captain Planet showed up right now, he'd be a little bit pissed, but I think I could tell him pretty succinctly, you know, Captain, I drive a hybrid. My vehicle burns both gas and oil.
There you go.
And even a little bit of coolant. So I'm kind of, you know, it's the trifecta.
So I'm having some video issue, but the people listening to this don't care. But I think Captain Planet is already here because I look blue on my screen. Oh. I think subconsciously that was going to your head there, Coy, and then just made you think of Captain Planet because there's three of us, and here I am with a blue head.
Jay, I need to send you a green mullet wig, buddy.
That look awesome. that'd be pretty accurate. Didn't he have like a white and red?
Oh man, it's been so long. He had like red boots and like a white outfit with red, like long red gloves, I think.
Wasn't his jacket just a giant Confederate flag? No?
I don't remember it that way.
That's why I like you guys, because even if we're not, you guys look like we're the relative age. And so we can kind of pick up on those jokes that half these people listening have no fucking idea about.
Don't insult your audience. Come on, Jay. You don't have to insult your audience.
Oh, they know.
People can go out there and they can look up Captain Planet if they want. I recommend if you're going to Google Captain Planet, I almost said Captain Planet, but that's actually Coy when he gets a turbo on
Pornhub.
Yeah. So if you're going to go out there and look up Captain Planet, make sure that you include Don Cheadle.
Hey, I'm sorry. Hang on a second. Captain. Somebody get on Pornhub right now and fact check that. Please let that be real. My wife's going to be like, what in the hell is your search history? And I'm like, look, I was fact checking someone. It's not.
I misspelled Captain and hit Captain Planet.
Likes his men like he likes his dick, short and fat.
That's right. Well, first off, what are you drinking before we go talk about? I asked him as he puts it up to his mouth.
Well, so actually, I brought this over for Coy to commemorate the first time we are using his studio. Normally, we use my studio, but Coy and I both have studios built in our homes. That's why our audio quality is on point. Coy, you have an irrational love for Captain Morgan's private stock.
Yes, I love Captain Morgan Private Stock rum. It's the top rum, I'm going to say. It could be second. There's another one that I've been liking lately. And a little Coke.
If I could find that other rum, I would have bought it because it's much better than
this. There's Coke in the rum, or you have Coke next to the rum?
No, there's Coke in the rum. Ironically, if you put just a splash of Coke Zero into this Captain Morgan's Private Stock, it tastes like a root beer.
I almost made a drink. Because I figured you guys would be drinking. And so for that, I apologize. I have some black cherry Waterloo, but that's not going to work.
You have black cherry Water lube.
Yeah, for Captain Planet over here. Oh.
Nice, dude.
Oh, Waterloo. Okay, yeah. I gotcha.
Yeah, water soluble lube.
It's sad how as I get older, I like slowly drink less and less soda, and I'm now just drinking like carbonated water with... It tastes like the fruit that it's named after, peed in it. You know, yeah, it's right. Like, oh, this is raspberry bubbly water. I'm like, oh, yeah, raspberry peat in this. I can just almost taste that it walked past this can of water.
It's like if a raspberry had COVID-19 and it sneezed into the glass.
If we go back a year, I'm not drinking this. I don't know what happened. But I wanted something that I could just open up the beer cooler downstairs and pull out and chug. So whether it's a Dos Equis or a carbonated water, it's something that wouldn't, you know, immediately put me on my ass.
So I've actually been finding myself a little bit irritated by the yeast recently in beer, which is a shame because I love beer. I actually started brewing beer, but it hasn't really gone too far because it messes with my system a little bit too much. So hard alcohol is kind of where I'm at. That's the happy medium for me. When's the last time you heard that, Coy? Pain pills and alcohol is my happy medium.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure that's like you're halfway to Charlie Sheen. You know, you're on the downhill descent.
Sure, I don't exactly have the tiger's blood, but we're moving up that way.
Definitely a downhill glide plane that you're...
Right,
that was the way I look at it, if I'm not sleeping on a park bench with a needle hand on my arm, I'm doing okay.
Or you're not in Portland.
Well, there is that. So I have to ask you something, Jay, since we're here and we're doing this thing. How is that non-specified problem in Arizona? Because here in Oregon, it's real bad, son.
Are we talking needles or COVID?
Needles, homeless, that sort of thing.
Yeah, I think Portlandia might be, it's like the tourist destination for the homeless. It's like homeless. Ooh. Yeah, it's like the homeless in like Phoenix. So like, we got to get out of here. We got to take a vacation. We got to go to Portland for a while and just lay out in the middle of the parks and shit. When I was there.
Yeah, I come back to Arizona for the winters, if I'm honest, because it's.
Are you
it's
homeless not the though? Cold.
I mean, I could be. The night's young and we're just starting your podcast. I just feel like the rain is a little bit too, I wouldn't want to be laying in the rain if I was homeless. That's my whole thing. You know, I think I would like to, if I were homeless, I would definitely vacation in Arizona.
I don't think we have the near, I think because of the extreme heat, we don't have the issues that, you know, you see starting go over the West Coast, you know, once you start, go to, you know, Los Angeles, you know, and you have blocks and blocks of tents, mm-hmm. overpasses, and you start getting up into Oakland and that beautiful city behind you, San Francisco, you know, it's the same deal. And as you get further up to where you guys, I think that's probably the peak.
Sure. Coy was telling me the other day, he's not exactly like a snowbird. That's what they call like retired people, you know, that go to warmer weather states in the wintertime. We're more snow bums.
No, yeah, that wasn't good.
I work in Portland. I do horizontal directional drilling. So pipes under roads and whatnot. So I'm down there with the people a lot of times and I see this homelessness on another level. And it is, for those who haven't been up close to it, it is unreal. Like it's like you're in another country for a moment. I mean, it's something else.
We're actually starting a program because we want to bring more awareness to the homeless problem here in Oregon. It's called a Bum Rush 2000. And this is a real thing. We're actually going to do this. So the rules for the Bum Rush 2000 or BR2K, as we like to call it, is you have to have a shopping cart. It has to have one wheel that both powers and brakes. Okay. Okay. You have to have, sorry, Coy, what's it called? The thing on the back that attaches to the shopping cart that you stand on. There's a name for it and I forget now.
Yeah. It has to be a standing platform. You have to be standing behind the shopping cart.
You need to look like you're pushing the shopping cart, right? So whether you achieve that by standing on the back of the shopping cart, or my preferred method is going to be having basically like a tiller set up on the back where there's two wheels, one on either side. And then I'm standing on a platform and that's attached to the shopping cart. We are going to make this happen. It is a real thing. We've already got our shopping carts. I probably have half a dozen people who are already working on these. And so rule number one is it has to look like you're pushing the shopping cart. Rule number two is you have to look the part, because obviously if we're doing this race in a very public area, we need to be able to blend in, if you understand what I'm talking about. Again, needs to be single wheel drive, needs to have the single wheel brake. I'm not limiting anything like the top speed. I'm not limiting safety, anything like that. Although I would recommend that you wear a helmet. I plan on getting the smallest helmet I can possibly fit and then maybe fitting like a KFC chicken bucket over the top. Weren't you talking about maybe wrapping yours in tinfoil?
Yeah, I'm going to go full like armadillo tinfoil hat.
But I don't think he's going to do the antennas. I think Coy's going to actually do a swan that's folded out of the tin foil on his helmet. And yeah, we're planning on doing a 1 or 2 mile race. We're going to have predetermined start and stop. And we plan on making this a series, by the way. I've already reached out and talked to a local go-kart track owner. I don't want to disclose too much, but we are planning on making this a racing series. And we are going to bring in, what do we got signed on so far? 11, 12 people so far?
We got about 12 people that are interested. We want to, during the gamblers, mm-hmm. at the party area, you know, the meeting rally point, we'd like to set it up and do some races.
Right. So with the gambler, they have this thing they call the Hoopty X. And that's where you essentially take your gambler car on a rally course. And then, of course, they have the mini bike racing.
That's completely separate from the gambler, though.
Yeah, that's completely separate from the gambler, but they do call it a Hoopty race, right?
I think it's just the gambler mini bike.
The
Hoopty race is just the Hoopty X or Hoopty Cross, depending on, they kind of call it both. But well, and it's like a 2 mile, basically, rally course.
Either way, we plan on doing a gambler transient X, which is going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be us racing our shopping carts across this BMX track that they normally have the mini bikes on. And I think it's going to be a really, really good time. Jay, right here
BMX
now,
track.
On your own podcast, I would like to extend an invite to you, my friend.
For the bum rush to the B2K?
BR2K,
yeah.
BR2K. Mm-hmm. Can I be a color commentator? Well, can I be a commentator?
You can be any color you want, buddy. We're already going to send you the green mullet. So, I mean, whatever you want to be.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to that. I'm no longer blue. I don't know what the hell happened. I don't know what happened.
It's self-correcting. It's self-correcting. You're self-correcting, all good now.
Yeah. So, Horsepower Hour.
Yeah.
How did you get started?
Well, so Quinn and I have been doing a podcast for a long time called Boost, Booze, and Barbecue.
Yep.
And it was our dream to kind of do a car podcast. We started out doing Boost, Booze, and Barbecue because it was cars, it was alcohol, it was barbecue. We felt like we'd have a larger range of people that we hit. It wasn't until later that we realized that, what's the saying, Coy? Niches make riches.
Yeah, we realized that we'd thrown too wide of a net, mm-hmm. and we're essentially losing listeners because somebody's who's signing on just for cars doesn't care about the booze or the alcohol. You know, he may not listen, and then vice versa. Somebody just interested in barbecue, and then that week we didn't do much barbecue talk, just did cars. They're, you know, just because you're into barbecue doesn't mean you love crappy Japanese sport compacts. So we realized that we needed to narrow in, and we kind of started putting together Horsepower Hour, and we're going to kind of hard launch it, and then COVID went down, and we kind of held off.
It wasn't COVID, remember? It was my car accident.
Well, there, yeah, you got in a pretty bad wreck.
Yeah, I got hit by a drunk driver and it collapsed 2 discs in my neck and gave me a pretty traumatic brain injury. And COVID was kind of icing on the cake, to be honest. I thought, you know, I'll give myself a little time to recover and then we'll launch the Horsepower Hour. But anyways, so the Horsepower Hour is an accumulation of all the things that we love and all of the things that we could do without from Boost, Booze, and Barbecue, what we used to call 3BQ. We still have all those episodes out there. I haven't deleted any of them. People can still listen to those. And man, there is some amazing content on that podcast. And we're trying to bring a lot of that good content over to the Horsepower. Absolutely. Don't you think?
So what's the low of the low though? Because it's difficult doing what we do. It's difficult to find new listeners. We can have golden content and it's just really difficult sometimes. And then when the next famous person decides, I'm going to do a podcast, you know, the pie is so big, but it still feels like they're kind of tugging at anything that you're trying to grab at. Like, what's the low of the low and why bail on it just because of that?
Well, it was a combination of factors and none of which are really, how should I put this? Coy and I, we love cars. We want to talk about cars.
It comes through.
Am I not?
Yeah, no, I've been a car guy since before I was allowed to drive cars.
Mm-hmm. And we both love to cook and we both love to barbecue.
And you've known each other for a while. Like I was one of your recent episodes, you were talking and you had mentioned to Coy, you guys were roommates at the time. So how long have you guys known each other?
Yeah, gosh, how long have I known you, Coy? 35 years?
Yeah, about 35, mm-hmm. going on 36.
Yeah.
His mom and my dad are siblings, so.
Okay.
So yeah, since birth, basically.
Yeah. How are you guys able to stay focused though, right? Because usually you get in these partnerships and there's always one co-host that just doesn't want to do shit anymore.
Well, so if I may, Coy. Oh, go ahead. No, go ahead.
From the beginning, I didn't do shit. So yeah. We started on that foot. I just bring my mouth and I don't really have any other talents. So we really rely heavily on Andy to do the social media, the editing, really all of the hard part. And I just show up and talk.
I would like to disagree with Coy and say, oh, no, he's just being modest. But no, he's 100% right. Okay, yeah. All he does is show up and talk. I will tell you, though, the thing that really keeps us a tight core group, and Coy's going to agree with me 100% when I say this, it's that big dick energy, you know?
I'm supposed to agree with you?
You have to. You guys have been literally hey, ride or die, homie. Penis. Ride or die. You better.
You've literally seen my penis. You know it's not big. Like, I don't even know why you would say that.
It's all relative.
What's that song we used to sing in grade school? Deep and wide. That's what the girls are singing when you
come. They called me Tuna Can Coy. Okay? It's not long.
No, you know, what keeps us going is just the fact that Coy and I both love doing this. And again, we both love cars. I'll tell you something, Jay. There is so much car information in my brain that I'll never do anything with. And it probably is even a detriment. You know, if I'm trying to learn a new skill, I'm sure there's car stuff in there that's like, nope, you don't get to remember that. I'm forcing it out because you need to remember what motor mounts go in a you know, 2M4 Fiero. You know, it's all in there. It's all caught. And so basically, the podcast for us, it's like a therapy session. You know, we're getting to release some of that knowledge. So hopefully we don't have to just sit and hang on to it for the rest of our lives. Is that fair enough, Coy?
That's fair. And I don't think people really understand nowadays with Facebook, the amount of time that car guys would spend poring over forms and just digesting something between raw data and then people's opinions about said raw data, thousands and thousands and thousands of pages of any car you were interested, any car you had, your buddy's car, somebody who had a car that knew you were a car guy that just wanted some help with something. And you're like, hang on, I'll just search the internet for 4 hours.
Use the search function, buddy.
Knowledgeable enough to give you an answer.
Let's cross-reference some of those magazines that we bought when we were 16 and, you know, rifle through those, because I know that there's some kind of a data about it in those magazines too.
So I remember some dude built one this way and you reach into your banana box of sport compact cars and start going through it, you know.
I didn't tell you this, Coy, but okay, so my nephew, we'll just kind of get into it. My nephew burned up the transmission in his 2006 Honda Civic Si. He's not going to listen to this podcast, so he's not going to be pissed off at me. So he's borrowing a car from a coworker. It's a 1.8 liter Sentra. It's a B15 Sentra. It's probably 2005-ish. And I just started randomly talking to him about, oh, yeah, the B13 Sentra had something real special. You know, the B13 Sentra, it came in an SER, and it had four-wheel disc brakes and a little bit, you know, change suspension. It had the SR20. It was still a DE. It wasn't the VE, but it had the SR20 DE naturally aspirated engine in it. It was very good. And the engines just, they had this certain thing, and the chassis just had something to them, you know. And then the B14 Sentra, blah, 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 blah. And then we get to the B15 Sentra, and I'm telling him all the reasons why the B15 Sentra is, it's good, but it's not quite as good. And it kind of fell on its face and people wanted to love it, but it's just not quite there. And he's just sitting there with this glazed look in his face, like, when is this guy going to shut the fuck up so that I can go back to watching this movie?
That's the look I have right now. But no, that's it. Exactly. No, but here's the thing. Here's why I love your guys' podcast. Like, real talk. You're relatable. You don't just read off of headlines of what's going on. I've dipped my toes into so many other automotive podcasts, and they are just, they sound like they just fell off of the DJ booth, and they're just so like commercial. And you can't identify them. They're always about trying to book the next highest profile Mr. So-and-so or Mrs. So-and-so from whatever. And it's like, for me, I'm like, I don't give a fuck about any of that shit. I want to listen to you. I want to laugh at your stories. I want to laugh at your segments. And I want to learn something, even if it's about freaking Nissan Sentras and the SERs and the different motors, you know. And that's what I love about your guys' podcast. And I think it's so hard to find that sound out there, whether it's just indie level like us or bigger, because a lot of people are like, oh, you do a car podcast? Yeah. Oh, have you listened to Car Talk on NPR? I have not. I have not, and I probably never will, because you lost me with NPR, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so it's fun, you know, the horsepower hour, and you guys have all these segments. And so, man, I mean, hopefully you guys keep doing it, because I enjoy listening to it.
Well, I'll tell you something right now. The segments, we both work on the segments. It can go either way. The smoking dealer, smoking a dupe, that's something we've been doing from the beginning.
That shit's funny as hell, too.
We've been doing that on Boost Booze Barbecue for I don't even know how long. And smoking dealer, smoking a dupe is where we take a car from Facebook Marketplace or Craigslist or wherever, and we review it, and we decide, is this car worth it? Is it not worth it? And inevitably, hilarity ensues, because Coy and I, we have this exhaustive automotive background to be able to pull from. And, you know, the pop culture references don't necessarily hurt either. So we're able to just kind of pull that out. You know, one of my favorites right now as Overland AF, and that is actually a segment that's very geared towards Coy, because Coy is a bit of an overlanding legend here in Oregon.
I don't know about all that. I do like to go camp in the hills and whatnot. So, Overland AF in the Overland community, it's kind of grown. It picked up a lot of the people from like the Honda, you know, the Honda craze and drift craze and all that. And they just buy a 4Runner and outfit it to the max. You know, it's got heavy bump. I mean, these things are 8,000 pounds or 2,000 pounds of gross vehicle weight, rooftop tents, trailers, and they look cool. Don't get me wrong. And they're amazing, but they're just way over the top. And it's always the newest gear. The Overlanders can almost get into like the PC guys, where it's like, oh, this is outdated. I'm getting the next coolest camp stove. Like, and it's like, what was Coleman still work? Like, they are old, but so there's a lot of cool stuff that comes out in the Overland world. Sometimes it's the fatty gear, you know, that last item that we'll kind of stop and make fun of. Last week it was a McMansion. Mm-hmm. That had an underground garage that just seemed over the top. So it's, you know, just kind of over the top automotive kind of outdoor stuff that we usually, you know, once in a while we throw in a hovercraft or something.
Oh, dude, one of my favorites was that floating tent. You remember that?
Yes.
I said that was the coolest and most expensive way to kill yourself on a river.
I sat there and looked at it. It was literally like, looked like a life raft, but it was an inflatable tent that you just popped out on the lake. And then slept in.
And don't get me wrong. Cool. Wasn't it fully inflatable? Like, didn't even the sides and everything, they were like tubes that inflated?
Yeah, no, it was legit, and it was expensive. I just wanted to try and like take it to a ski slope and fill that thing up, get like six people in there, just see where you ended up. Because, I mean, you could peek out the window, but you can't steer it. You're inside of a tent.
There's a quick correction here. What he actually wanted to do was convince one of his drunk friends to set it up at the top of a ski slope and then fall asleep and then push him off the side.
And then record that shit.
Yes.
Go viral.
At least 4 GoPros inside, for sure.
Yeah, and we're actually working on a new segment that we will break on your, I've solely made this decision.
This we're going to break this breaking on news? Your show.
Breaking news.
Okay. Oh, snap.
Just for you, Jay. We're coming up with a new segment called Fabricated Suicide. So we always come across these great, you know, somebody builds an LS go-kart.
Yep.
Street bike powered something, you know. Milk, you know, like the milk delivery van things with V8s or street bikes in. These just home fabricated. They look awesome and I would drive it, but it's a like surefire way to kill yourself. Right. And we're going to start popping some of those up in a fabricated suicide segment.
Yes.
It's like was it on your guys' Facebook page? Someone had posted the guy with the shopping cart. So this is why women live longer than men. Here's at the drag strip.
Yeah.
That sounds right.
Yeah, and just a quick plug for you guys out there. The Horsepower Hour podcast, literally just facebook.com/group/the Horsepower Hour podcast. If you come over and check that out, we post a lot of the same stuff that you know and love over on Hard Parking Violations. That's why I'm a part of Hard Parking Violations. But you are going to miss out on some seriously hardcore automotive stuff. You don't come and check that group out. The Horsepower Hour podcast, which is a group on Facebook. Please do come and join, because seriously, Jay, I love you. You post amazing stuff.
I probably spend more time on your page than mine.
In the mood. way, you know, we all have our vices, right?
Yep.
But if somebody is just feeling like they need to come and check out like really hardcore, ridiculous automotive shit, there is the craziest stuff being posted over on the Horsepower Hour. Seriously.
You know, you just reminded me, could you just clear this up? Your Mazda Protege. I'd mentioned your old school Protege, and I probably got the numbers and everything else wrong. So for the record, can you tell us what you were doing in that thing? What it was pushing out and like, what fuck are you doing with it?
Yeah. So it was a 1991 Mazda Protege. Someone had brought it over from, I don't know, fucking Norway or some shit like that. Thought they were going to stage rally and then realized that it wasn't legal here. They brought it down from Canada, but it was originally, you know, imported to Norway or whatever. Dude thought that he was going to do stage rally in Washington. Turns out can't do stage rally in a non-production U.S. vehicle. And so it just sat for a number of years. And then I ended up getting the drive train from it, did a fully built Mazda BP motor, a balanced blueprint, all that good stuff. It had a GTX 2876R turbo on it, put out 340-ish horsepower to the tire. It was all-wheel drive. That's probably not something I should
feel like out. You're missing out an integral part of this.
What's that?
That motor was in a Festiva first.
Yeah, it was. The Festiva was,
Fastival, as we called it.
Fastiva.
My wife called it Festivus Prime. So the Festiva, it got to the point where all it was good for was racing sport bikes on the freeway. And so I decided to kind of change gears with my projects. So the reason why I got the Protege all-wheel drive is because it was 2,600 pounds, made 340 horse tire. Jeez. And it was one of the quickest cars that I've driven, honestly. I mean, not top end, you know, anything that goes more than 135 miles an hour is going to be able to beat this, but that's because I had these short rally gears. Right. And one of my favorite things to do was to race Subarus around town because they had no idea what they were in for. Now, I'm not advocating as a 35-year-old man that you should go out there and build a car specifically for street racing. That's not what I'm saying. However, if you do it, it will instantly make your dick longer.
Tuna can, Koi, where's yours?
Where's mine?
Where's your, car? I don't know if you built one of those based on what you were saying earlier.
I originally back in the day, I had a Civic hatchback that was, I was big into autocrossing. So I built it for the class at the time. And I just had a B18 kind of a all motor setup. I had the SI limited slip transmission from Japan. It had a little shorter gear ratio going on in it.
Than the Type R, right?
Yeah, it has a shorter gear ratio than the Type R. It's the transmission you wanted if you're doing an all motor setup. And then I ran slicks. They were 13x9 steels with, I can't even remember. It's been too long. Giant Mickey Thompson.
And all you have O-dot to do slicks. Is just, if you can imagine what a Hot Wheels car looked like in the 80s, that's what his car looked like.
And then I just ran some Falcon Hanabi 15-inch. And then I'd run like whatever the go-to street tire was then that was 200 tread wear, you know?
And actually,
street tire.
I need to tell a funny story, Jay. One time we were in autocross, Koi had shown up and he put on his 13x9 Hoosier slick tires to race. And then we were getting ready to drive home and he was throwing on his street tires, which again, and we're getting super technical here, but they were Falcon, Zenis. Were they the RT615 at that point?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So it was right after the RT615 had come out, and that was a very hot tire for the street tire class. And so we were changing our tires over, and this guy comes walking by. Again, this is an autocross event. And he comes walking by, and he goes, you're changing your tires. And Koi goes, yeah. And he goes, well, are you, like, you ran the street mod class earlier. Are you running street tire class now? And Koi goes, no. And the dude was like, well, why are you putting race tires back on your car? And Koi looks up at him dead faced. I will never forget this. He looks up at him and he goes, hey man, if you want to be hardcore, you got to be hardcore. And that dude, literally, I watched his fucking brain explode. He was just sitting there like, what? People like this exist? Oh my God. But of course, at the time we all ran autocross tires on the street because we were all racing more than we were racing. Not that I probably should be inventing that, but you know, it is what it is. That is like a quintessential Koi moment for me, is when that dude's mind was blown and then he looked at him and he said, if you want to be hardcore, you got to be hardcore. And the dude just, did he say anything after you said that?
It's kind of a, like a wow, man, I can't believe it type. I can't remember. Yeah, it was, yeah. This was years ago. But yeah, if you want to be hardcore, you actually have to be hardcore, bro. And
essential coy.
Put my tires back on.
Yeah.
I like that.
And the dude was absolutely blown.
I ran the Civic for a while. I had an S2000 that I built and gutted and turned into kind of full race car, half cage. And
boy. He had a four loco can paint job on it. It was pretty slick.
Sold that to a 17-year-old and had kids and stuff. And then recently picked up a 2001 MR2 Spider.
Those are those little micronized ones, aren't they? The MRSs?
Yeah, MRS. Mm-hmm. Yeah, little tiny guy. Everybody asks me how I fit in it. And I just say, I don't. I actually wear it. I put it on. Yeah. So
when he gets out of that car, it gives birth to him.
Right. All right, let's do your top five.
The Horsepower Hour presents this month's top five of the week today.
All right, what are you guys hitting me with?
Quay, you want to lead this one?
So top five mods that you just don't see anymore. Going old school, Jay. I feel like you're in the age group where you can appreciate some of these. And I'm going to start out with Nalgene spark plug wires.
Oh, shit.
That's right.
Most nobody has spark plug wires anymore, but they were insanely expensive capacitor spark plug wires that came in multiple colors, supposedly added horsepower. And if you had them, you were super cool.
Guaranteed to give you a hotter spark every single time. Hot spark, right. Hot spark, yep. Because it was that capacitance. Coy, do we know if those were actually like legit? Were they capacitance?
I think they were actually legit, but I don't know. Do you, Jay, do you know if those were like an actual performance product?
If people on the forum say they were, then they were.
There was really no way to fact check a lot of this YouTube performance stuff back before Facebook and YouTube. It was just like, yeah, they work.
Yep. Jay, did you run Nology wires on your NSX?
I didn't have an NSX back then, but I may have tried to stick them on an Integra.
Yes. That is the correct vehicle for them to go on. Congratulations.
Yep. I'm not going to lie. There was a point when I had a clear, like red, it was like a clear red distributor cover on a D16 motor. So you could see the rotor sparking. It was super cool back then. Super lame.
It'd be super cool right now. What else? that's one of five.
Koi, one of my favorites is actually the grounding kits, man.
Oh,
I've heard those were legit. Those were a big deal. You got to get that ground kit, bro. Extra ground to your motor. Supposedly made more power. Shit, I don't
hanging
know
if off that was the real rear bumper causing little sparks on the ground.
Possibly. I don't know.
My buddy had one on his Accord. He had one on his Accord and he sold them too.
They always said that was super hot. Like you wanted the best performance from your ignition. You had to have the proper grounding kit and somehow the grounding kit was going to give you more horsepower. I never understood how that was going to work, but there you go.
Dude, the spark was so much harder. Spark's way harder. Number three. Vortex throttle body spacers, bro. Do you know how many people I knew that ran these?
Number three.
And when you think about them, how could they work?
Right.
How? Like it's basically, it's basically threaded. It didn't even really have like jet vanes. Like even if the air hit that, it would have to come to almost a complete stop, turn 90 degrees and then start spinning.
If anything, they were an air restriction.
Oh, I'm sorry. Those are the superchargers.
Yeah.
Those were the eBay superchargers. Yes.
They were the eBay superchargers. Yeah.
Koi, my next favorite one. And I used to see these all the time and now they're gone. The hubcaps with the fake disc brakes in them.
Oh,
if you didn't have disc brakes in the rear, that means you had a base model car. How do you fix that? You throw on some fucking hubcaps and make it look like you got disc brakes, baby.
And if you weren't running Steelies, they made one that went over your lugs and then you bolted your alloy wheel over there and it was a fake disc brake to cover your drum.
Oh my goodness. Yes.
How pathetic.
I'm just sitting here shaking my head because I've seen some crazy shit, but those are pretty fucking crazy.
We have one more.
Well, we have more than one.
One more. We've got the four. Let's get the fifth one out.
Underglow, baby.
Ooh.
I don't know about you. Maybe in Arizona, it's a big deal still. Here, the street racers or the ricers or whatever you want to call them nowadays, underglows, it's non-existent. The off-roaders, though, now have rock lights, but they'll run them in crazy colors. So it left the street race scene
different, and got off-roads. Mm-hmm. No, that they're back. That's something.
What?
Yeah, that's something in the 90s. We called them neons.
Yeah.
And now the underglows are back, but now they're cool because you're using LEDs.
Well, like back in the day, though, the problem with the underglows is like they would break a lot. They were like an expensive item to maintain.
Yeah.
Yeah. But now with the LEDs, I mean, you've got all these guys that are basically getting into cars now, but they're a computer guy first. So they have their RGB keyboard and now their car can match that. They've got the RGB lights. I'll give you our true fifth right now. Stick on vents for cars.
Oh, sure. Stick them right on the hood, on the side. Mm-hmm. Take the, not even 3M tape. They come with like this bullshit Alibaba tape.
You get a vent.
And you get a vent. Yep.
You get a vent.
I want to see a guy pull up in a raised truck with the underglow, but I want it to be because so the Infiniti that I just bought, it's got the where you open the door and it's got the little emblem on the ground. But I want to see a big truck pull up and then just spray on the ground this like giant fucking Pac-Man game. And I want to watch Pac-Man kind of pecking around on the tarmac and chasing ghosts and shit.
Bro, it's 2021. Why aren't we already doing that? Seriously.
Seriously? You want to go pop culture? We need to roll up and have them Bluetooth connect, and like you could do Pokemon games against the other guy's door at night.
Oh, goodness, yeah, yes.
I choose you, and throw your door open.
That'd be awesome.
Bro, I have such a nostalgia boner. You have no idea. I would love that. Are you kidding me?
Aha! You didn't know I throw my passenger door open.
Remember how sane that Pokemon Go was like 3-4 years ago?
Oh, it was
nuts. That thing like swept the world.
Imagine if Pokemon Go had landed around the same time as COVID. What a flop.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody would have been outside walking around.
Running, actually, would have
been perfect.
Yeah, that's true. All right. Now, for the real actual number five of our top five list, big fiberglass wings.
I don't know. Is that something people don't do anymore?
I haven't seen one in a long time. It started with Wings West Body Kits and Arabini. And they had those big, huge fiberglass kits. And then they fell in love with the Supra's spoiler. Who else had the big spoiler? Was it the Evo, the Mitsubishi? Somebody had the big spoiler on the back, the double decker. And then everybody had the double decker Sentra SERs.
Yeah, the Tommy Mackinnon or whatever it was, spoiler. Yeah.
Well, we were talking about that
just a couple weeks ago
on the Horsepower Hour. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the STIs that.
With the veins.
What generation is that with the veins, the uprights, and the STI spoiler, Jay?
You're asking.
That was the first generation.
Yeah, I don't know. That's the big fat. Yeah, that's what, 92 to 94 STI?
No, World Rally. That's going to be 2000.
It was right
after. 7, 8, 9.
They did have a vein in the center of those, but right after the Bug Eyes, then I don't know the chassis.
Yeah, I don't know.
Sorry, guys. But right after Bug Eyes, when we went from WRX to actual STIs.
Mm-hmm.
They had a dual vein.
Okay.
And you got to be real careful. The reason why Koi is saying the one after the Bug Eye, it's not because he doesn't know what they call the one after the Bug Eye. It's because it's a little bit racial. So he's trying to stay away from that.
Good job. Well,
I'm just saying.
That's not the chassis code.
No, it's not, but it's the colloquialism.
Yes, they called it a slant eye. Okay.
Whoa.
I never called it that.
We have standards on this show. And I don't want to get canceled because of that.
I said they did. Other people.
They.
I am.
Not you.
Just to be clear, I am 1/16 Cherokee, and I have DNA stuff to prove it. So.
So after the Bug Eye was the S word, I, S2000. That's the one that we're talking about.
SDI.
SDI. Yes.
That one had a dual vein, I believe.
Yeah, so I'm going to go ahead and agree with you on all of those. They're all really good.
Well, you should, because, I mean, we're right.
Yeah, yeah, of course. That's why you're on here. It's time for the Q&A segment sponsored by The Credit Mix. Fix your credit. So this time, so usually what I do is
would it be if you were sponsored by Credit Week and your credit was actually super fucked up, how ironic would that be?
I mean, they don't have to know.
And I'm sorry to interrupt. I apologize. I was sitting here thinking to myself, imagine if Koi and I, we both have great credit. Mine's over 800. I'm sure yours is close to that. Uh-huh.
Mine's at least as high as my IQ.
So he's got a credit score to 90.
you guys represent. That's why you're so good together. You get the whole spectrum covered.
Right. Yeah. we're on the same spectrum. I just wish it wasn't autism, but we're there, you know.
Each of you guys have to pick one car to race across the United States, but here's the thing. Can't have over 130 horsepower. Which one are you taking? Boy. We're going to give or take 30 horsepower because I don't know what... I can just guess with cars that don't have shit. In fact, you guys had some shitty-ass cars a couple episodes ago. I was listening to it when I was getting my COVID shot. So you can't...
Those were some shitty cars, yeah.
Those were some shitty cars, so... You think about those cars you have to pick, and you can't pick the Chevy Spark.
Okay, so I already know, and you'll have to double fact check me. Lotus Elise, not the American version, but the European variant, had a Range Rover motor in it that was wildly underpowered and horrible. But it was still the Lotus that we know and love. So just imagine, I'm pretty sure they were like 130 horsepower.
That thing ran like high 13s, didn't it? Mid to high 13s because it weighed nothing?
No, ours did because it had a 2ZZ motor in it. The European one, because they came out in Europe in like 99 or 2000. They came out here like 2006, I believe. And they upgraded the motor when they came here. I'm going to take a European spec Lotus Elise.
And by the way, the Europeans deserve that garbage spec car because they call... French fries chips, and they call chips crisps, and they call their friends cunts, and I'm just like, no,
man. I'm always confused. No. When I get fish and chips and it's fries. What are you taking, Andy?
Under 100 and what'd you say, 30 horsepower?
I think so.
And this is a race. Am I understanding that correctly?
You have to beat Koi across the United States.
This is actually a pretty easy one for me. I'm going to do a Lincoln Town Car because they're so choked down. They have virtually no horsepower, but they do have a V8. So there is some torque to be had there. They're super plush, super comfortable. Could you imagine Koi trying to sleep in this Lotus Elise?
They got to at least have trash. How much? Hold on. They have to have at least, like, I'm thinking 170 horsepower, right?
The Lotus?
No, the town car.
Meh. I don't know about that, dude.
To be fair, I just fact-checked myself, and the European one did have 134 horsepower.
So he's already out of the
race. I am cheating technically.
You're four over. Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm going to go ahead and take a Crown Vic.
Take your Crown Vic.
I am. I'm going to take my Crown Vic. It's going to have the crushed velour interior. Have you ever been in one of those cars, Jay?
Mm-hmm.
Not in handcuffs. I'm talking about like a...
No, the ones that I were in had the leather. Wow. Yeah.
They're very comfortable.
Yeah.
And you can stretch out.
Pleather.
You can lean out. You know, you can put your hands behind your head. Like, you can really kick back in those. So not only am I winning, but I'm winning in comfort. Those are very nice. And here's the thing, Jay. Here's the thing. So I don't know where exactly I'm catching up with Koi, because obviously we're starting at different spots. That way he doesn't know what my car looks like. That's going to be important for me.
No, we're doing, I'm going to back up. We're doing Cannonball Run rules, you know, where you're both there. So you have to race to your car and then get the hell out of there.
Okay, all right.
And then when you get to the finish line, you have to race and punch the ticket.
Well, I don't know if you've ever watched a classic, amazing, one of the best Bruce Willis movies ever called The Jackal.
Yes.
But I'm going to paint my car.
Is it weird all I remember about The Jackal is he kissed some other guy?
Yeah. Well, it wasn't. He wasn't cheating on his wife because he was going to kill the guy later.
Yeah, right.
That's the way it works. Like, if you kiss another dude and then you kill him later, then that doesn't change the status of your sexuality.
It doesn't. It's just, it's just part of the job. That's
a zero sum.
Yep.
You made the kiss, which moves your sexuality up, and then you kill them, which moves it back down. So, you know, really, he didn't move the needle at all. I need you to not look at the 2-hour scale. I need you to look at the 24-hour scale. But anyways, I'm going to paint my car with that paint that I can just wash right off. And I'm going to do that immediately. And then I know this for a fact because I've been riding with Koi before when this happens. He's going to be barreling down the highway at 115 miles an hour. And he is going to see what appears to be a cop car in his rearview mirror. And he's going to slam on his brakes and move all the way over into the slow lane, possibly even exit off of the highway thinking that he needs to get away from this cop. Meanwhile, guess what, motherfucker? That was me. That Crown Vic.
Flying by
I just
comfort.
Sailed on past.
I like that. And that might work. You forgot that I'm doing a cross country race. I started this race chuck full of trucker speed. and I'm going to finish that way. So you act like you're going to stop and sleep. I'll sleep when I'm dead. Literally. I may die at the end it. So
you're going to do like that astronaut. Remember that astronaut who drove across the country in a fucking diaper to catch her cheating husband or some shit.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
That's a thing.
Coy's never put in a catheter before, but he's going to fucking learn. I mean,
I am fluent at peeing in a Red Bull can. Yeah. And when you throw it out the window, it just looks like you dropped half a can of Red Bull. So it's not even really littering.
Next question, last question. And this is another crappy question.
This was a short Q&A, buddy.
But these are long answers. Favorite scene or favorite car movie, and it could be most unrealistic. Like, what do you like to watch over and over again? If the world loves it or the world hates it, you don't care.
I got to think about this.
A movie, one of the greatest cinematic pleasures I've ever had the opportunity to watch. 200 miles an hour.
You sure? What about Red Line?
No, 200 miles an hour still beats it out. That is one of the greatest automotive movies in history.
Never heard of it.
I highly recommend it. Not only, I don't want you to be high when you watch this movie.
Is it on sci-fi or is it like a real movie? Into an edible
trip. No, it's a real movie. It's a real movie.
It's called,
you gotta go and check it out. It's called 200 miles an hour.
200 miles.
Don't just be high. Don't smoke weed and then watch this movie. I need you to eat edibles. I need you to wait 3 hours. And then I need you to do some fat dabs. You have to be completely gone. If you want to crossfade a little bit, that's okay too. Go ahead and get yourself, start having an out of body experience.
Some limits should never be crossed. That's literally on the movie poster.
This is one of the greatest. People talk about how the Fast and the Furious is one of the greatest street racing movies of all time. Nay, nay. 200 miles an hour, 200 MPH for those out there in the UK.
Yeah, I had to write it. Actually, I had to write it twice because the first time looked like I wrote like Zumbuth. So they had to put the little space. So now it's 200 space MPH.
Can I talk about that movie?
Just a quick insider baseball for people. Jay in about 4 days is going to text me, what in the real and actual fuck? And that's all the text is going to say, but I'm going to know exactly what he's talking about.
You really do need to watch that movie. If I had thought of that first, I would have put it out there. Yes. It is so good, bad, good. It's something else. At a certain point, you feel like, did they actually have a budget? Because some of the props, like when they zoom in on the speedometer, says PSI, but you can see how they whited it out. Stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then when it says 80.
So when was this movie made? I'm picturing like a 1982 movie.
Dude, I'm pretty sure it wasn't that old because wasn't like Justin Pollock the drifter or something, like the tech coordinator?
Yes.
Apparently did nothing.
They had a pro drifter as their technical coordinator, which just actually proves my theory that drifters are the worst car people on the planet.
The first thing you'll notice is he's driving on a green RX-7, and every time you'll see him like throw the steering wheel like he's, you know, flying around a corner. Mm-hmm. It zooms out and like an S14 240 SX goes sliding around the corner. Mm-hmm. It's green with a wing. It's similar, but clearly a different car. And then just goes back to him. Like any car guy wouldn't notice it was a completely different car.
And that same sliding corner action happens 4 or 5 times in the movie. The very same
reusing it
every single time. Yeah. Rich. It's sort of like, you remember watching the Scooby-Doo cartoons when you were a kid, mm-hmm. and they would run past the same armoire and nightstand like a dozen times. Yep. It was that kind of a thing.
Coy, do you have a movie are you sharing movies?
I do. It is called The Rendezvous. It is an old, like 70s movie. I don't know my Ferraris, but it's an older, cool Ferrari. Well,
it actually doesn't matter because they dubbed in the engine sound.
Yeah. It's an older Ferrari. And they were ripping this thing through Paris. And there's no plot. There's no talking. Just a dude gets in a Ferrari mm-hmm. and starts driving through Paris. What somebody told me, and I never actually fact-checked this, is they actually got in a lot of trouble because they didn't pull any permits for this movie. They just took this Ferrari and just went balls to the walls through Paris for 2-3 hours.
It wasn't actually a Ferrari.
I've heard this before. I think mm-hmm. somebody famous has said that's their favorite movie too.
And then at the very end, he finally pulls out on this bluff and gets out. And then just, you know, this stunning French chick walks out and like gives him a hug, and it's, you know, kind of sunset and the end, and that's it.
Yep.
But it's
that was just a Rendezvous.
Yeah. It's just, no talking, just Ferrari engine sounds and just ripping through Paris.
And if I may, I actually want to give an honorable mention to something. It's not a film. It's a series of films. It's called BMW Films.
Oh, Clive Owens. Yeah.
Yeah. Clive Owens as the driver in BMW Films. Mm. There's anyone listening to this podcast that has not watched those. It's easy. Just go to YouTube and type in BMW Films, the driver, and you'll have two seasons worth of these videos. Every single video has a different high profile director that was in them. They all have different high profile actors in them. Madonna, Don Cheadle, again, Clive Owen. Oh, wow.
That's interesting.
I mean, they all are super high budget short films produced by BMW, and they are amazing.
I think the first one that got it so famous and started out had Madonna in it.
Yeah.
And it even back in the day, it had the, what was that? Was it like 741? One of the punk bands like kind of put one of their songs on it that was a hit, and you know, it was a big deal.
Yeah. That song, woohoo!
Woohoo! I know that song.
And it's been an empty. That song. You know what I'm talking about. Yep.
Yeah. Everybody knows it. Woo-hoo. I don't
need you. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have that written down. BMW Films, yeah. The Driver, 200 miles an hour. I don't have Rendezvous because I can't spell it.
No, don't try to spell it. And yeah, just so you know, up. It's like, just so you know, when you do try to spell Rendezvous and something pops up in like 2005, I'm going to say Nissan tried to remake that with a 350Z for like an advertisement. It was
no good.
Hot trash. So do not watch it if it has 350Z.
Well, it's got VQ noises, which is just not. It sounds like a penguin farting into a solo cup. It's awful.
I'm trying to imagine what that sounds like.
Here, let me give you a little taster here.
That's yeah, that's okay. All right. Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, it was pretty good.
That was good. Yeah, it was real good.
Straight pipe. Yeah.
Clearly, it was a straight pipe. Oh, no. We lost.
The green screen, the green screen is out. Now I know your secret. You motherfuckers aren't in San Francisco.
No. You just said, fuck you.
I'm still in San Francisco. A green hot air balloon smashed against my penthouse.
Okay. Yeah.
That's why it's like this.
Guys, you want to tell everyone how to get a hold of you?
I'm pretty sure there's a guy down in the gondola. Hey, buddy, you okay? No, he's not okay.
He's gondola.
He's definitely not okay.
Andy Coy. We're doing it live. Guys, thanks for joining the Hard Parking Podcast. If people want to get a hold of you guys.
Yeah, facebook.com/thehorsepowerhour. Don't forget the Horsepower Hour. Instagram is the Horsepower Hour. Twitter, we have a Twitter, but we don't ever use it because Twitter is a fucking cesspool. So don't even try to follow our Twitter. Come and check us out on Facebook and Instagram. Coy, of course, can be found at the same place. Just make sure that you title like Andy or Coy. Usually the messages that come from me are like, hey, Andy, I have these questions about cars. Then the ones that come for Coy are like, hey, Coy, why are you bald? You know, it's stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, if you want to send us your questions, comments, concerns, I would love that. Also, if you do listen to the Horsepower Hour and find that Horsepower Hour podcast anywhere, we're not mutually exclusive. You can get us on Spreaker, Spotify, iTunes, SoundCloud, yada, 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 blah, 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 all of the podcatchers. But what we do ask, and this is a personal favor for Coy.
For me.
That you leave a review. If you like the show, please, please do leave us a like, leave us a review. We want to see those reviews.
I'm not even asking for a good review.
It's funny. I just said that on an episode that I launched. I was like, look, man, just give me a fucking review.
Yeah.
Yep.
So as a matter of fact, Jay, just today, like literally just today on YouTube, our latest episode dropped. The very first comment was a dude that said, it's good. Shame I can't share it. And then he downvoted the video. And then Jesus. My comment back to him was, you can't share it from YouTube. You're on YouTube right now, but you can't share it.
You There's posted no that. Way I saw for that. You
to share it
yeah,
fucking. From YouTube. And you know what? We appreciate him for doing it. I applaud him for, I assume it's a him. His name was Mr. Something. I assume it's a him. We applaud him for reaching out to us and saying, hey, I like your show, but it's hot garbage because I can't share it. And then I had the opportunity to say, it's on YouTube. You can share it anywhere. You're just too stupid to figure it out. It was a very nice, it was refreshing. And we really appreciated that someone would take the time to interact with us that way.
Yes.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Jay. Appreciate you.
Special thanks to Andy Himhoff and Corey Sinclair of the Horsepower Hour podcast. You can watch them on YouTube. You can visit their Horsepower Hour Facebook page. You can check out the podcast. It's a good mix up to this one. A little more car talk than mine. If you like what you heard today, subscribe to the podcast and go tell a friend about it. Then come back next week. I got some special shows coming up. Need to thank Wright Honda, Scottsdale, Arizona, higher quality detail, booster bath, four-wheel online, tongue treats, and Cell Shop Wireless Services, Patreon business supporter, Kuya Automotive, out of Winter Garden, Florida. Speaking of Patreon, if you're in a position to help the podcast grow, seriously, guys, for as little as $3 a month, head over to patreon.com/hardparkingpodcast. The link is also in the description. Get access to bonus audio. With this last interview with Horsepower Hour Podcast, we had about 5-6 minutes of just bullshitting and messing around before we actually started. And I have that with a lot of people. So you might want to go check that out. Also gives you special access to show swag. Again, this is a little $3 a month. There's also a link in Anchor FM description on this podcast for as little as 99 cents a month. That's like buying me a cup of coffee. Pick up some show swag at Teespring store. The link is also in the show description. If you want to follow me on Instagram, that's NA2NSX or J Travels. That's JHAE_travels. Join the Hard Parking Violations Facebook page. Go out there and type in Hard Parking Violations or Hard Parking Podcast, Hard Parking Violations, Hard Parking Podcast, and you'll find the page. Check out the YouTube Hard Parking Media or Hard Parking Podcast. It seems like I just cannot decide what I want to do with this stuff. But most importantly, I can't grow without you telling the world how good the show is. So let's do this. Let's grow this thing together, and I'll talk to you all next week. For over a decade, 4Wheel Online has been bringing the best truck accessories and truck parts to enhance the appearance and performance of all trucks and SUVs. They're dedicated to providing an extensive range of upgrades that will match any maker model on the road. Their truck products cover everything you need for a custom look and added functionality. I was talking about a wheel and tire package. Head over and use a configuration tool. They carry all the major brands of wheels and tires, so go get outfitted today. Visit them at 4Wheel Online. That's 4Wheel, singular, online. Are you tired of blowing out your back at the bathtub while washing your dog or subjecting your canine to a water torture bath while leashed up to a post outside? Now there's a far more effective way to wash your pet while saving your back and keeping your dog happy. It's called Booster Bath, a portable bathtub on legs. Head over to boosterbath.com, one word, and pick one up. Available in 3 sizes, this tub system features a drain, a soap cubby, and water-controlling wand. This tub conveniently breaks down to be stored when not in use. Want to save 10% on your first-time purchase? Head over and sign up today to make that happen. Boosterbath.com.
Shut up!